Mark D'Agostino from Southern New England Air, Nose, and Throat Group, affiliated with Middlesex Hospital Center for Advanced Surgery. I'm part of the otolaryngology section of surgery here at Middlesex Hospital. We perform various types of head and neck surgery, surgery for head and neck cancer, including sinus surgery, thyroid, salivary gland surgeries, ear surgery, throat, and procedures for obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. When we see a patient in the office who we suspect may have obstructive sleep apnea, the first thing we'll do is we'll send them for a sleep study. Sleep study is an overnight study that's performed in a lab. Sometimes it can be performed at home as well. Many parameters are measured throughout the evening, including the patient's oxygenation, their body position, the different stages of sleep that they're in, and attempts in the airflow and attempts at respiration as well. And we'll see the patient back in the office after the sleep study, and we'll be able to go over these results with them. Once obstructive sleep apnea syndrome is diagnosed, now we proceed with treatment. And there's various treatment options for sleep apnea. The primary treatment, and probably the best treatment, is what's called CPAP. That stands for continuous positive airway pressure. CPAP involves a patient wearing a mask. The mask may cover the nose, or the nose and mouth, or it may just be prongs that go into the nose. The mask is attached to a hose and then a small machine. When the patient attempts to breathe at night, the machine will kick on and it blows air into the upper airway, keeping it from collapsing. It's not oxygen, it's just a positive pressure, a pneumatic splint that keeps the airway open. Patients that can tolerate the CPAP usually feel much better in the morning, and their sleep apnea is, for all intents and purposes, treated. Another treatment option for sleep apnea is the use of what's called a mandibular repositioning device or a mandibular advancement device. And these are essentially mouth guards that are made by special dentists that are certified in sleep medicine. And what the mouthpiece does is it'll hold the lower jaw forward, and attached to the lower jaw is the tongue. So by pulling the tongue and the jaw forward, you're keeping the airway open. And patients with mild to moderate sleep apnea oftentimes will do very well with a mandibular device. It keeps the airway open at night and it helps with their breathing as well. There are some patients that can't tolerate this or have some jaw problems or are not candidates for the mandibular repositioning device, but still can't tolerate the CPAP. Those are the patients that will look at some of the surgical options. From a surgical standpoint, we look at the airway and where it's collapsing. The airway is all soft tissue. There's no bone in the upper airway. When the patient's relaxed at night, all their muscles are relaxed, and when they attempt to breathe in, they're sucking the whole airway closed. And there's three levels that we look at where the obstruction may occur. One is the nasal cavity. Two is the back of the throat, the tonsils and the palate and the uvula that hangs down off the palate. And the third is the base of the tongue, which is right above the voice box. When the patient's sleeping at night, all those muscles are relaxed. As they're breathing in, they're creating a negative pressure, and those tissues are sucked shut and they're closing off the airway. This obstruction is much more pronounced in people that are overweight. As we gain weight, we put on weight in the pharyngeal tissues, which is the back of the throat and the tongue, narrowing the airway even further. In some patients, the standard procedures looking at the palate, the tonsils, and the nasal cavity are just not enough for them. They continue to have sleep apnea because they're obstructing farther down at the base of the tongue. Surgically, the base of tongue is a tougher area to address. Previous procedures would involve fracturing the jaw and pulling it forward, which will help pull the tongue forward. There's procedures where a suture will go around the base of the tongue and it will anchor inside the jaw with a screw. There's a procedure where a window could be made in the bone here and pull that forward. That's where the tongue attaches, and that'll pull the tongue with it. We've now developed a way where we can approach the base of the tongue going through the mouth and shaving some off the base of the tongue without any fracturing of the bone or sutures to hold the tongue forward. So using the daVinci robot, we can go through the oral cavity to remove tissue at the base of the tongue, thus helping open up the airway. This avoids the more invasive procedures such as fracturing the jaw. Using the daVinci robot in the oral cavity is what is known as transoral robotic surgery, or TORS, T-O-R-S. This was initially for cancer procedures, but now we have revolutionized this to use it for patients with sleep apnea. Myself and a few other doctors across the country have adapted this technique for patients with obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. Middlesex Hospital is now one of a few centers worldwide where the robotic surgery is being used for obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. Patients who would be considered candidates for this type of procedure would be patients who have had surgery before addressing the palate and nasal cavity but have persistent apnea. Additionally, patients who cannot use CPAP or cannot or will not use a mandibular device may be considered candidates as well. So this procedure may be considered an option for patients who thought that they were out of options for treating their sleep apnea. The console provides a three-dimensional, high-definition, magnified view of the operative site, one which would not be possible without the robotic camera in the oral cavity. My fingertips here will control the fine movements of the robotic arms at the surgery site.